It's a plane!
No, it's just plane radio.
Yeah.
The show devoted exclusively to flying and the aviation lifestyle.
I can fly.
Brought to you by JustPlaneRadio.com.
It's your lucky day.
Your aviation resource on the information super skyway.
You got a plane.
Call Just Plane Radio toll-free now at 888-884-2FLY.
And the sky's the limit.
That's 888-884-2359.
Sir, I'd like to take the helm, please.
I'd be glad to. Greg, your co-pilot, that's me along with Captain Dennis. We are your crew today for Just Plane Radio, the show devoted to the aviation lifestyle and learning to fly. All right, so we got a lot of stuff to navigate today. And we probably should have talked about this last week because it was all over the mainstream media. It's kind of come and gone. But, you know, it's kind of nutty because you don't hear this kind of story very often. And, of course, I'm referring to the airplane that dropped a bunch of fuel on some school kids in California. What is the deal with that, Dennis?
It's unfortunate, but a Delta Airlines flight from Los Angeles to Shanghai was having engine problems shortly after takeoff, and they needed to quickly get back to the airport. Well, unfortunately, when you're loading up a 777 for a very long flight like that, it actually carries more fuel and more weight than it can actually safely land with. So the procedure for the pilots is to dump fuel. Normally this isn't an issue. They do it above 10,000 feet. It gives the fuel plenty of time to actually evaporate and never actually reaches the ground. But because this happened right after takeoff and they needed to get on the pavement as soon as possible, they were dumping fuel at only 2,500 feet as they were going over residential neighborhoods and industrial areas trying to get back to the airport. And at that altitude, it didn't have time to disperse, and unfortunately it fell as a liquid onto some unfortunate kids out on the recess.
Yeah, that's not good. And you know, you saw it all over the news, but it wasn't just the kids that got sprayed, I'm guessing, man. It was a whole area there? Or has anyone else complained, or what?
There's been, you know, lots of complaints. I saw, you know, initially they were saying 25, and it's like 60, and lots of public service people were heading out to assess what was going on and the health risks. Some of the teachers were saying it was, you know, kind of hard to breathe because you could smell the jet fuel in the air, and then as it evaporated, a lot of that went away. You know, me, years ago, I used to live near Minneapolis International, and every now and then we'd have something similar where, you know, 747 would lose an engine and have to come back. At one time, I remember it being a controversy, and the airline actually picked up car washes for everybody that lived within the affected area because, you know, some of that jet fuel might have gotten on their car, you know, and they were trying to do the right thing. And I'm sure Delta's going to step up, and, you know, this is a huge PR nightmare, obviously, and you know, not to mention the potential public health risk, too. So I'm sure they're going to do their best to take care of everybody, but it is unfortunate. But if they did dump it, the risk to the airplane and, you know, several hundred passengers on there would have been quite severe because the landing gears do not allow to take that amount of weight, especially with, you know, coming in and touching down. It just tends not to be as smooth as touching down a pillow, you know. It tends to come in rather firm.
Yeah. Well, so, what do we know about
open the fuel tanks?
What do we know about, you know, taking showers and avgas? I don't know. Was it avgas or diesel? What would it have been?
It was kerosene. Jet.
All right, so I don't know. Just smell like,
well, at least there's not the lead pumping.
Yeah, but I mean, you think they knew it right away just because of the smell? You know, what it was?
Well, they saw the plane coming over, and they said you could see the streams coming out of the wingtips.
Well, did anyone go, hey, they're dumping their restroom right all over us? But wait, it's not flu.
I'm sure the conspiracy theorists were all over this. Oh, they left the chemtrail switch on too low.
Right. Yeah, of course. It's right.
Put your tinfoil hats on.
Yeah, well. Well, you know, obviously we can't have this happen. And, you know, they got a pretty good excuse.
And I'm sure that they'll be updating their procedures to, you know, in the future. At least from LAX, it's only like, you know, a minute or two after takeoff, you're over open water. And yeah, maybe they're going to put some restrictions in place. But remember that in an emergency like this, and I don't know what specifically the issue was if they totally lost that engine, but the rules say in the event of an emergency, the pilot command can deviate from any rule. So, you know, we could put all the processes and procedures in place, but if it's, you know, he's trying to protect his passengers.
little jet fuel shower, but we want to live. So you can't blame them if you can do that, is the case. So, you know, but, you can't help but feel sorry for the kids, too. You don't hear about this type of stuff very often. The only story
you don't want to take a bath in the kerosene shower, right?
No. But it's kind of interesting. I've never heard of this before, and obviously it's had to happen. But that got a lot of play. It seemed like on the mainstream media. You know, normally in these type of things, it's like, airplane parts falling off in people's yards and that blue ice that we, talk about quite a bit.
And escape slides, things
right.
like that.
Exactly. But you don't hear about the jet fuel showers hardly at all. So that was kind of a unique thing. So anyway, they'll work it out. Just something to be aware of. And I don't know. Would you rather have a jet? That's not a golden shower. So that's a...
Well, it is kind of a straw color.
Yeah. I'm trying to think if you had your choice. But that may be deeper than we want to go into.
Yeah, our passengers really want to go into that.
Let's navigate to something else, something more positive. You know, we're just a week away, or thereabouts from Super Bowl in Miami. You know, all the stars from Hollywood and California, they're going to be converging on South Florida next weekend. And there are some things you need to be aware of as a private pilot, right?
That's correct. The FAA has just published their newest notum on this as a reminder that you now have to, if you're planning to...
Captain, has time to fasten your seatbelt. Time to ask that all passengers take your seat at this time and please fasten your seatbelt.
If you're planning on flying up there yourself, be aware that...
Just as a reminder, we cannot leave the gate until carry-on items are properly put away. All overhead bins are closed and all passengers are seated.
Search for the FAA Flight Super Bowl 54 flight advisory, and they have all of the restrictions that are going to be set in place.
Boarding is now complete. Flight attendants, prepare the cabins. Verify arm door. Standby for all call.
VOR, which is going to be basically it's kind of like a presidential TFR, no fly zone type.
All right, we've got everyone strapped in. Give us a ring if you need anything.
And there'll be absolutely no drone operations within the 10 nautical mile. Well, so don't think that you're going to be able to get your little DJI Phantom out there and start taking pictures of the Super Bowl from the parking lot. That's going to be that's a no-fly zone. Again, check your notams, take a look and see what you need to be aware of as you're flying anything in that area. It's going to be busy.
Basically, if you don't know that the Super Bowl is happening next weekend because you're living under a rock or something, stay away from South Florida if you want to fly your plane. All the snowbirds up there, this is a great time. They want to get south. But next weekend in South Florida is not going to be the weekend to do it. Fly out to the Caribbean. Go somewhere else. But avoid South Florida
they're
like a plague.
Oh, they're not going to be able, during the...
All right, Captain. Got the directions. Let me know through the menu when you're ready.
No practice instrument approaches, no aerobatic flight, glider operations, parachutes, ultralights, hang gliding, balloon, prop dusting.
No space.
So, pretty much anything you'd want to do other than take off and get out of the area is pretty much going to be clamped down on. So.
Yeah, stay away. I mean, unless you have tickets, of course, and you've made the proper arrangements. But, obviously, if you've taken that step, you've obviously planned, I would think, if you're planning to fly your plane in and have a reservation and all that kind of stuff to park your plane at the airports in the area. But boy, it'd be like flying into Air Venture almost. Next weekend, wouldn't it? It'd be like flying into an air show, I bet.
It's probably only with a lot more expensive airplanes.
True, very expensive airplanes, no question. But just as chaotic is my prediction. But who knows? I think it's one of those things. Like, if you had the opportunity, it'd be kind of fun to do something like that. To kind of mark it off the list. Like, hey, I got Super Bowl tickets, which is amazing in itself. But I'm actually going to fly my plane in like a big shot. We like the big guys.
I wouldn't recommend doing that because 2 years ago we had the Super Bowl here in Minnesota. The frozen north,
right.
That whole thing. Our airport was one of the most heavily impacted. And I mean, they shut down two of our three runways just to use for parking. It was totally chaos. And I had thought I'd try to go maybe fly just to say I could do it. And when I saw all of the headaches that people were dealing with, getting in and out and whatnot. I said, you know what? I'm going to go take it to the avionics shop. We're going to start working on the Avidyne install early. It was far the better decision than trying to deal with.
Well, once again, like I said,
great news, Captain. Your toe's coming. Shows,
like Sun and Fun or Air Venture, you know, it would be something you really have to plan for and to, it kind of check off the list. It's not on your list. Is that what you're trying to say, Dennis?
Well, in this case, I mean, I thought it would be kind of fun since it was right here in my backyard. But
right.
I don't know.
It wasn't. Sounded like a scarring experience or something.
Exactly.
Okay. We'll leave it at that. More coming up on Just Plane Radio. Stay close.
Just Plane Radio, the show devoted exclusively to flying and the aviation lifestyle.
Imagine traveling twice as fast as you can drive. Imagine taking friends and family snorkeling, surfing, skiing, shopping, and more to exotic destinations. Imagine attending...
All right, looks like the doors and hatches are closed and we're ready to connect.
...at home at night. Or just imagine exploring the wild blue yonder. Quit dreaming about it and get to it. There has never been a better time to become a private pilot. And flight training professionals in Orlando will show you how. Flight Training Professionals in Orlando is your full-service flight school. A state-of-the-art flight simulator, a fleet of the latest Cessna aircraft, and a staff of full-time seasoned flight instructors are just a few of the many reasons Flight Training Professionals in Orlando is the place to start your aviation adventure. Call 407-896-0077. That's 407-896-0077. Or go to ftpros.com.
That's welcome aboard, Captain. Toes connected. Bypass pens inserted. Go and kill the parking brake when you're ready to go.
Or simply an aviation enthusiast, there is a place for you as a member of the Aircraft Owners and Pilots Association. Join AOPA.
Here comes the pushback. Light them up.
Aviation news, safety resources, and technical support you need to sharpen your skills and become a central part of the nation's vibrant general aviation community. Learn more about becoming a member at AOPA.org. That's AOPA.org.
Explore in the other two-thirds of your world. Be the buddy who takes the kids in the aquarium instead of just to it. Be adventurous. Be amazed. Be a diver.
Exclusively to flying and the aviation lifestyle.
You nervous?
Never flown before.
Nothing to it. Just sit back, be a bird, drink up.
Sometimes I cry, sometimes I fly like a bird.
This is Just Plane Radio. Greg, your co-pilot. That's me, along with Captain Dennis. We're your crew navigating the latest aviation news and information and reminding you to stay away from South Florida next week unless you got tickets to the Super Bowl. It's going to be an airspace you will not want to navigate, especially if you're a general aviation enthusiast. I think it's just going to be way too crazy and not a lot of fun. Unless you got tickets, then it might be worth it.
Just about done here. Go ahead and set your parking brake.
Let's go out to the Caribbean. Do something more fun.
And we're disconnecting the tow. Give me just a moment.
Stuff. You know, all the NOTAMs are out there. You can look them up and know how to. Well, once again, they'll tell you how to navigate it. I say just avoid it. Now, there's some other areas that you want to look at as well as far as, are these NOTAMs or just notices or updates?
It's a new NOTAM.
Okay. What is this? Isn't this for DC area? Right.
Yeah, the Washington D.C. area has had some very special rules put in place post 9/11. One of which is that you now are required to have special awareness training if you're going to fly within 60 nautical miles of the D.C. airports, and they have updated now the NOTAM that's kind of controlling.
And we're disconnected. Signal and pin on the right. Take it easy and have a safe flight.
They now have published specific VFR corridors that you now have to use to fly into those airports. So you can't just cross over and enter as willy-nilly, you now have to come in on specific radials off of the Potomac VOR. So they've updated the NOTAM to reflect all of that and published it. Unfortunately, they haven't updated the training classes. So if you go out and take the special rules training, it's still going to have the old procedures there. So it's in your best interest. AOPA is urging it as well to take a look at those NOTAMs before you depart. Make sure that you take the training if you haven't already and know that the training's out of date and that the procedures have been updated. It also affects the Leesburg Executive Airport, which if you've noticed in the news, they're getting one of these remote control towers. And so they're going to be assigning transponder code 1234 to people flying in and out of Leesburg so that the remote air traffic control tower can manage that traffic separately.
Okay, so that's just in that whole D.C. area, which, you would think they would have those type of things set up already. They have that in New York City already, right, where they got to fly along the Hudson and stuff?
Well, those are VFR corridors, but this is, that was to be able to transit in between some of the heavy class Bravo traffic between, like, LaGuardia and Kennedy and things like that, and still
right.
be able to not have to be talking directly to a controller. But this is for people that want to go and fly in and land at these airports. It used to be you could kind of cut over, any way you want, cut under the shelves here or there. Now they're actually mandating that you come in within these pie wedges specifically, so that if you're going into, the northernmost airport, you're going to be required to come in, somewhere between the 345 and 105 radials and things like that, so that they are kind of vectoring the arrivals into certain areas.
Right. So, in something like this, if I was a new pilot and I had just got trained on that and the training had not been updated and I'd missed the NOTAM, well, it's all on me. Yeah, you can't use that excuse like, hey, wait a minute, they just told me I was supposed to do it like this and now you say that's not right. What? You're in trouble regardless, right?
It's your responsibility to make yourself aware of all pertinent information and NOTAMs affecting the airports of landing. And so this is why we're trying to get the word out that, hey, there's a change. This is new and probably won't be the last time they update it.
Yeah, but I didn't know is not a valid excuse.
No. Or yet another reason to get your instrument rating and file. And then you don't have to worry about this. They'll tell you where you go.
Okay. Well, yeah. So, because that would be a VFR approach is what you're talking about.
Yeah. Right. This NOTAM is specifically for VFR arrivals into
right.
those three.
But if you violate it, what's going to happen?
Plan on getting a call from the FISDO and, sitting down with their examiner.
Hey, idiot.
What happened? You could get your license suspended. Best case, you probably wind up going and doing some remedial training with an aviation safety counselor and having to do what they call a 709 ride with the FAA to prove that you still are able to exercise the privileges of your certificate.
Yes, you're capable of reading and flying for sure, too. Okay, well, there you go. Now you know if you didn't already. Planning to fly around. Have you done that route, by the way? Have you flown up there by the Capitol?
I have never been to the East Coast unless we call the East Coast of Florida, but it's definitely on a short list of things I need to go do.
That would be a fun, I think it would be an excellent trip, wouldn't it? I mean,
I think
it'd
be great.
Can you even get close enough to fly through the areas like Congress and stuff? That's probably no fly zone.
No, I think if you were to get close to that, you'd probably have
May
a Blackhawk off your wing.
Back. Yeah. Right. But can you even get close enough where you even see any of those type of landmarks, you think, or no?
Don't know. Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't know. I've never been over there, so
okay.
I don't know how close.
That.
I mean, if you go into College Park, I have seen some videos that people put out of a couple of the DC-3 airports where if you went into them, yeah, you are flying, relatively close to some of the big facilities. So it might be possible.
Yeah,
to
I don't
see.
Know. The TFR around the whole area there has to be massive. I'm sure of it. So anyway, it would be cool, but you maybe get some great shots. You just may not get back down to the, well, actually you might,
well, you may get shot, your
might,
call.
Yeah. You get back down to the ground quicker than you might expect.
And you're greeted with a bunch of blacked out limousines to pick you up, right?
Mm-hmm. Possibly. So, yeah, probably don't want to do that. But it would be fun. There's a lot of those things they don't let us do. do, which is probably a good thing. All right, so Garmin, they came out with some news, too, that, I don't know, would have been a solution for you a couple of years ago, but you're all set now. But for folks with, like, a Mooney or typical, what, a Cessna 172, have some old, you know, old gauges and things, and they're looking to upgrade, Garmin finally came out with a solution or something, or what?
Yeah, it's actually this. Some of this could even go into my Mooney as well, but this is geared towards people that haven't gone to the full glass retrofits. You know, haven't put in a Dynon or a Garmin 500 or so G3X or something like that to replace their six pack gauges. Garmin just released a Swiss Army knife, I guess is a good way to describe it. It's a 3 1/8 inch gauge. It fits in a standard instrument bowl, and it's actually a round display as opposed to that G5 that they put out several years ago, which was a square box that would slip into an existing instrument hole. This thing actually fits in the round bezel just like the gauge it would be replacing. And it's great. It looks very nice, but it's a Swiss Army knife. It can be an attitude indicator, so if your artificial horizon goes out, instead of paying to have it overhauled, just take it out. Drop this in, doesn't need vacuum, but it can also display kind of like the typical glass cockpit where you get your airspeed and altitude can also be superimposed on it.
Well, there you go. More options if you're looking for an upgrade. Or a way to bridge that gap before you go full glass, right?
And it can do much more, which we can talk about after the break.
We will on Just Plain Radio.
Just Plain Radio, the show devoted exclusively to flying and the aviation lifestyle.
I've been up around the stratosphere at 31,000 feet. I'm going to fly on out of here on you can't see. If you're gonna fly high without fear, you're gonna have to learn to love the atmosphere, and you gotta learn to use those wings you can't see.
This is Just Plain Radio. Greg, a co-pilot, that is me, along with Captain Dennis. All right, so this new Garmin retrofit gauge that you can pop in your older GA aircraft is a round standard, you know, one of those six-pack gauge. What is the diameter of that thing? That's a standard.
It's a standard 3 1/8 inch instrument.
Okay. So you can put it in any of those six spots, and it's all digital and stuff, so you can use whatever feature you want on it and that kind of thing. Or how's it? How do they work?
Yep. Just switch the pages. So it can be an engine monitor for you. It can act as a artificial horizon, as we already talked about, which gives you kind of that moving map with your tapes and everything on it. It can be a heading indicator or an HSI, so it can give you your navigation and all of that information on there. It can act as a multifunction display where it can show traffic, maps, just like you would get in the middle of a Cirrus, only a lot smaller. But even more interesting, it's also going to be your primary engine monitor, so they're attacking, they're going after pretty much every bit.
80 knots.
V1
rotating.
Before, and that's all we do. We do it really well.
Positive rate.
This new Garmin system not only does that, but all this other navigation stuff by just pressing the button. That's what's on the page, right?
Exactly. And what I thought was really impressive 400. Is that, you know, for a gauge that can be anywhere from $4,000 to $5,000, the options you have, this thing can replace and back up multiple other gauges.
1,000.
Exclusively to flying and aviation lifestyle.
5,000 to go.
This is Just Plane Radio. Greg, your co-pilot. That's me along with Captain Dennis, navigating the latest aviation news and information. Okay, so, you know, we've covered a lot so far. And, you know, there may be some places that you want to fly, like maybe you need a new place just to live, but you want some aviation connection to it, like an airport nearby. We're going to cover that in just a bit, give you some 10 suggestions on where to potentially buy, a second home for your airplane. We'll kind of call it that, I guess. That's coming up. But first, we've got some other topical news. You know, we're based in Orlando, Florida, at least I am. Dennis is up in Minnesota. But Vero Beach just up the road from...
They're not able to apply for a lot of the grants and subsidies that they would have gotten as a GA-only airport.
Got it.
So they're actually looking at kicking out that scheduled airline and going back to being a GA-only, not having to deal with the security overhead of the TSA requirements for fencing and things like that, and being able to get some of those grants that they're missing.
Right. You know, sometimes there are some advantages to being small. So, and yeah, and they're just up the road from Daytona International, which has been, they've been trying to, up their profile the last few years. So I would imagine that maybe they're feeling a little bit of the pressure and competition from some of the carriers that are just flying in Daytona. Yeah.
Well, and you've got Orlando, which is, obviously the largest magnet in the area that, a lot of people look at how cheap it is to fly to Orlando and figure it's probably worth it just to rent a car and drive.
Right.
You got Daytona, Melbourne, now Orlando, Sanford is starting to get more and more of the smaller airlines like Elite, Spirit, or Allegiant, and Spirit, and some of these.
Thousand to go.
Some of these outlying airports that start to become a little bit more viable. Alternative, too. So there's additional pressure on it from that respect.
Right. And, plus having that hometown feel. I bet they're like, it's crappy now. I remember a few years ago, boy, this airport was awesome. They had the best hamburgers at Fannie Mae's $100 hamburger joint. That kind of stuff. You don't really think of Vero Beach as a tourism mecca necessarily either, especially when you put it up against a Daytona or Orlando. I mean, Orlando Sanford has the same issue as it's, they're competing with MCO, Orlando International Airport, heavily as well. Like I said, they got Allegiant there. But the problem is they definitely use the Orlando moniker more than they use Sanford. Because people, they go, Sanford, Florida? Where's Sanford, Florida? Well, it's actually right outside of Orlando. I live literally right between Orlando Sanford and Orlando International. They're almost equal. And I'll go to Sanford. Up where you are to Minnesota or Cincinnati even, or Dayton, things like that. Legion runs flights that are dirt cheap. I mean, Michigan, you know, they definitely got some flights in Orlando-Sanford. But once again, they call it Orlando-Sanford. They don't just call it Sanford. There's been all kinds of legal challenges between the two airports for that little marketing scam that Orlando-Sanford has been put into. But I guess they're okay with it for now. But Vero Beach, you know, we'll see where it goes. And I wish them well, regardless. You know, I think, you know, when you're flying your craft, and I mean, wouldn't you rather go to a smaller place like Vero as opposed to, say, Daytona International or something if you're flying down this way?
If it was my choice, yes. Just because I don't want to deal with the extra headache and frustration of the large airport that overheads. You know, tends to be those bigger airports are also the ones that have the bigger FBOs that have charged
more
under fire.
Fuel.
Yeah, exactly. Handling fees, all of that kind of stuff. So, yeah, flying into some of the smaller airports, in my case, can be a lot of fun. But it is nice to know that there are the bigger airports there that if the weather's down or need maintenance or something like that, there's a good chance that you'll find a provider there readily available. It may not be the cheapest, but you'll always have that option.
Right. But you can always take off and fly to one of the big places if you need some maintenance type stuff done. But if you're just flying around for fun, it's way more fun to go to these little small, family-operated airports or whatever, or community airports and things like that. Which brings us to 10 places where you can buy, what is this, a beach house that not only you will like, but it'll be possibly good in this regard if you want to fly your plane into cool places, you know, that have small airports nearby, right?
It's something along that lines. You know, this is an article from our friend Trevor at in-flight pilot training here in Minneapolis. But, you know, he put together a top 10 list of beach property, places that you can get a beach home that are still accessible by a small general aviation airport. So a lot of people, hey, I want to get a beach house. Where do you go? You get something that you get a connection to Orlando or to Miami or Fort Lauderdale, some of these big airports that you can take an airline. But if you're a pilot, you can go to a lot of other places that are on, you know, like we just said, the smaller airports, the little homey feel of a smaller FBO, and it's less busy. So he laid out some of the options, and one of them is not really your back door, but at least it's your state. His first choice was Panama City Beach, Florida.
Okay.
You know, you do have a fairly big airport there at Pensacola, but if you wanted to go to Panama City Beach, that's farther to the east and away from some of the hustle and bustle of the military traffic over there. The Northwest Florida Beaches International Airport is actually one of the closest ones that can service you. But you get the bright blue waters, the white sand beaches of Florida, but you're away from some of the high-end
hustle and
traffic.
Bustle.
Yeah, hustle and bustle, exactly.
And driving that area kind of blows, too. So if you can fly right in there and avoid a lot of that driving time and landing right in Panama City, that does sound like a win. What other locations did he suggest?
Dauphin Island, Alabama.
Okay.
You can fly into Jeremiah Denton Airport there. And it's known as the Sunset Capital of Alabama. It provides a little quieter city, but it still has the beauty. It's only about 1,000 people, but you can find a beach home there, golf parks, golf courses and parks and marinas. So, and if you needed to, 30 miles away here at Mobile. So if you did need to catch a commercial flight or something, it's not that far. But being able to go to the smaller airport again, you avoid the hustle and bustle and headache with the larger airspace.
Okay, do we have 10 of these?
We got 10 of these.
Okay, so that's two. What's the third one?
Ocean Shores, Washington. So if you wanted to be on the left coast, they say medium home prices are in the $240,000 price range. But it's a quaint little coastal city in Northwest. Gives vacationers to experience a change of seasons. So if you don't want, you know, year-round, one temperature, obviously who wouldn't want that? But hey, it's to each their own. There's an option in the Pacific that would be close. And the Ocean Shores Municipal Airport would be a good place to fly in.
Well, you're in Minnesota. You'd want to fly down to Panama City.
I think I want to be farther south because I've been in Panama City when the temperature was only 40 degrees. Which
right, but you haven't been.
It's only 10 degrees warmer.
You haven't been in Orlando in August.
July.
You have.
I've been in Miami in July and August. fast.
Okay, so you know that's the time when the Floridians would like to go up to a place like Washington or whatever, like you just said, and have a place up there to watch the leaves go. Like, oh, this is what it feels like. Oh, yeah. We enjoy that cool weather. Very short patches of it in like the 60s or so is what I'm talking about at the lowest.
Just Plane Radio, the show devoted exclusively to flying and the aviation lifestyle.
Be an explorer in the other two-thirds of your world. Be the buddy who takes the kids in the aquarium instead of just to it. Be adventurous.
For nearly 75 years, the Aircraft Owners and Pilots Association has been a beacon for those who cherish the freedom to fly. AOPA protects your rights as a pilot by fighting airspace restrictions, fuel taxes, user fees, airport closings, and other issues that threaten your ability to take to the sky. AOPA is on the front lines every day to ensure that general aviation and the interests of its members are promoted and safeguarded. Learn more about how you can become a member at AOPA.org.
Imagine traveling twice as fast as you can drive. Imagine taking friends and family snorkeling, surfing, skiing, shopping, and more to exotic destinations. Imagine attending business meetings in cities far away and still making it home at night. Or just imagine exploring the wild blue yonder. Quit dreaming about it and get to it. There has never been a better time to become a private pilot, and flight training professionals in Orlando will show you how. Flight Training Professionals in Orlando is your full-service flight school. A state-of-the-art flight simulator, a fleet of the latest Cessna aircraft, and a staff of full-time seasoned flight instructors are just a few of the many reasons Flight Training Professionals in Orlando is the place to start your aviation adventure. Call 407-896-0077. That's 407-896-0077. Or go to ftpros.com. That's ftpros.com.
That's me along with Captain Dennis. All right, so we've covered three places that might be cool. Beach houses for you to own if you have an airplane to boot, and because you can fly in for easy access. That's what it's all about. You know, a lot of these small towns or the suggestions that we're throwing out there, that is 99% of it is access. If you can get there easy in your aircraft, I mean, man, that is a win-win because you got less people, less traffic. Just more, you know, just fun flying available to you without all the craziness of, you know, airports and loads of people and stuff like that. So we got three. Where's the next location?
The next one's Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. Now, of course, we do have a major airport there, but there are a number of smaller airports like the Grand Strand Airport surrounding Myrtle Beach. And with a town that's got over 2,000 restaurants and 100 golf courses, this one might appeal to you as well. Plus, it's still got gorgeous beaches. The only downside here is because it is a more popular destination, you might have to deal with a lot of tourists.
You do. But if you have your own little beach house, you'll be off by yourself. And if you want to go fight the tourists, you can.
And you can fly into an airport that they're not going into, so
right.
You have to deal with those crowds. And
like it.
100 golf courses, you got to be able to find one or two that aren't full of
course. Yeah, that sounds good. What's next?
Palm Springs, California, heading out to the West Coast.
That would have to be very expensive, wouldn't it?
Yeah, maybe a little bit more. But, you know, if you don't want to live in Phoenix, you know, this would be a good alternative for kind of the desert climate. But, you know, you've got the big lake out there, so you still get sort of that classic beachfront experience in Palm Springs. Okay. And it's still considered a top beach destination, but you've also got golfing, swimming, and other sorts of relaxation you can do up there as well. And the Bermuda Dunes Airport would be an option to fly into.
Now, you might see some celebs out there, too. They're star
Very watching. Possible.
They do that like Clint Eastwood. Harrison Ford's probably out there, too, isn't he? I bet he's
Where is he, right?
Good point. He has a few planes. He'll crash into you sooner or later. Okay, and the next place, what do you think?
Ocean City, Maryland. So if you're not looking for, you know, super hot climate, you know, it's fairly moderate on the east coast there. But the Ocean City Municipal Airport is what Trevor kind of recommends. And you get 10 miles of shoreline on this little spit of land called Ocean City. But they do have 9 million visitors a year. But you have access to a number of spectacular neighborhoods, oceanfront restaurants, plenty of new boardwalks and amusement parks.
Well,
a different pace of life.
Yeah. No, I can see what we're doing. We're covering, you know, cool places where you can get like a beach home that has a small little airport nearby to make it really convenient for your general aviation, you know, fun. What's the next one?
Portsmouth, Virginia. Close to Colonial Williamsburg, Norfolk, and Virginia Beach. It's another place for people that want to, you know, kind of get away. A little bit less traditional than the tropical locations. But you can get a second home near the water or on the water. They've got the historic neighborhoods itself, the seawall, views of the Atlantic.
A lot of history.
History, exactly.
Okay, I like it. Next one?
Jacksonville, North Carolina. Back down a little bit more warmer, especially for beach season, boating, fishing, turtle watching. So you can do that using the Albert Ellis Airport.
Okay, and what's special about Jacksonville, North Carolina, though? I don't know. Other than, I mean, it can be very scenic in the area, right?
Yeah, I think there's just some of the best beach activity in the area.
So. Yeah, I'm not that familiar with that area. So.
And maybe that's the whole key, is that people aren't that familiar with it. So you get all the benefits of a beach town without the crowds.
Got it. All right, we got what, 2, 3 left?
We got 2 left.
Okay.
This one might be a little bit impractical unless you're above a higher income level than me, but Hilo, Hawaii. If you're flying to Hilo International Airport, you know, instead of flying into Honolulu or Maui or some of those, but that's something that you're probably not going to do in your average Cirrus. The trip over the pond from Hawaii is a little bit more than it is like going to the Bahamas.
Right. It is. Maybe you just get it over there somehow. You ship it on a boat.
Well, you can get somebody to carry you to transport them over. They put big fuel tanks and they take the back seats out. You can do it, but it's not going to be something you're going to be taking off from your house in L.A. and flying out to Hilo for the weekend in your airplane.
Well, you fly around the islands. That's what you do. You punch around. That'd be kind of cool. I didn't even think about that option. But, it's a U.S. territory, so you can get a home out there and get in one of the less populated islands and have a plane. That'd be pretty nice.
And you don't have to clear customs because you're in the U.S. the whole time.
Exactly. All right, what's the last one? Is it the best? Was it in order or no?
Well, no. This one I kind of disagree with, but I live in Minnesota. But as you said, you know, you in Florida kind of want to get away from the heat, so Stillwater, Minnesota. It's on the shores of the St. Croix River, some of the most beautiful scenery here in the Minneapolis area or central Minnesota.
Yeah.
So it's not a tropical destination by any means. In fact, you've got 12 inches of snow on deck and more coming in cold weather. But, hey, you want to get away from it, from the heat, come on up here. In the summertime, it can be gorgeous.
Well, is that like on a big lake or something, too? Or?
It's on the St. Croix River. So they're huge bluffs overlooking the St. Croix. It was established back in the 1840s, so many vacationers, the second homeowners, love living in this area because of the river views, the historic town. But it's close enough to the Twin Cities that you can get to anything you would need in Minneapolis. Vegas or St. Paul.
So if we could go up there, say July, August, it'd be like it is in Orlando right now. 75,
yep.
Sunny. Something to consider for your general aviation lifestyle. We'll leave it at that. Till next time, remember, there's no better high
than learning to fly.
Just Plane Radio is brought to you by JustPlaneRadio.com.
I say we take off and nuke the entire site from orbit.
Your aviation resource on the information super skyway.
It's the only way to be sure.
Just Plane Radio is a production of Overboard Entertainment Incorporated.
With Plane Law.
Remember, you can listen live or to archives of past shows worldwide over the internet at JustPlaneRadio.com.
I'm going to lead my people up to the radio tower.
So tell a friend and take off every week with Just Plane Radio.
And I'm going to make a call.
The show devoted exclusively to flying and the aviation lifestyle.
What's up, everybody? High news.
The opinions you just heard on Just Plane Radio are those of the hosts, callers, and guests.
We are screwed.
They are not necessarily those of any station or network, its management, or advertisers.
Go too far, cross the line.
There are many factors to consider before learning to fly.
What is your problem?
So make sure you do your own research and get the proper instruction before your exploration into aviation.
Thank you very much, sir.
Have any questions or comments? Feel free to do so via the web at JustPlaneRadio.com.
400.